الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. عن زينب بنت جحش رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت: أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل عليها يوما فزعا يقول: لا إله إلا الله، ويل للعرب من شر قد اقترب، فتح اليوم من ردم يأجوج ومأجوج مثل هذه، وحلق بأصبعيه الإبهام والتي تليها. My respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Many a time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would address the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een and inform the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een of the fitna, the turmoil that lay hidden in the womb of the future. Many a time he would talk to them about the minor and major signs of Qiyamah, so that they begin to fear Allah and prepare for the life hereafter, so that their iman and faith increases when they see these signs appear. One day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent the whole day talking about the turmoil that was buried in the past and what lay hidden in the womb of the future. Abu Zayd radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates: صلى بنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الفجر وصعد المنبر فخطبنا حتى حضرت الظهر. The Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم led us in the morning prayer. After the prayer, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم climbed the minbar, the pulpit. He addressed us and kept on addressing us till it was time for the Zuhr prayer. فنزل فصلى ثم صعد المنبر فخطبنا حتى حضرت العصر. It was time for the Zuhr prayer. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam descended. He led us in the Zuhr prayer. Yet again, after the Zuhr prayer, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam climbed the minbar and addressed us and kept on addressing us till it was time for the Asr prayer. ثم نزل فصلى ثم صعد المنبر فخطبنا حتى غربت الشمس فأخبرنا بما كان وبما هو كائن فأعلمنا أحفظنا. He came down, he led us in the Asr prayer. Yet again after the Asr prayer, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not give us permission to go back to our houses. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yet again climbed the minbar and addressed us and kept on addressing us till the sun set. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us of the turmoil and fitna that lay buried in the past and what lay hidden in the womb of the future. It is because of ahadith like this and many other ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I have agreed with Brother Abdullah to do a few talks, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills, on the major signs of Qiyamah, especially now that the majority of the minor signs have already appeared. Many people
have claimed to be the Mahdi, the guided one. Let us begin today with Ya'juj and Ma'juj, the two tribes of Gog and Magog. As the iron wall they have been imprisoned behind has become weak, as is one of the meanings of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated by Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu ta'ala anha. Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu ta'ala anha says, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل عليه يوما فزعا يقول لا إله إلا الله ويل للعرب من شر قد اقترب فتح اليوم من ردم يأجوج ومأجوج مثل هذه وحلق بأصبعيه الإبهام والتي تليها. The رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم one day came to a very frightened. The words on his lips, لا إله إلا الله. There is no God worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيْلُ لِلْأَرَبِ مِنْ شَرٍ قَدْ اقْتَرَبْ. Destruction is upon the Arabs on account of that evil which has come close to them. فُتِحَ الْيَوْمَ مِنْ رَدْمِ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ مِثْلُ هَذِهِ. Today, a hole as big as this has opened in the wall of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. To indicate the size of the hole, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a ring with his index finger and thumb and showed the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een. However, one cannot give a talk on the Ya'juj and Ma'juj without giving Dhulqarnayn a mention. As it was Dhulqarnayn who imprisoned the two tribes of Ya'juj and Ma'juj behind the iron wall, the iron gate he built. This is why I have decided to go over the tafsir, the commentary of the 11th ruku of Surah Al-Kahf, as it is in this ruku the story of Dhulqarnayn and the story of Ya'juj and Ma'juj has been related. Explaining those verses very briefly which do not concern today's lesson. The Quran says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ قُلْ سَأَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they asked you about Dhulqarnayn. The Quraysh at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Jews, asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam three questions to test him, to see whether he truly was the Prophet of Allah, whether he truly was the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he's able to answer these questions, then he truly is the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if he is not able to answer these questions, then he is not the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first question they asked was regarding the Ashabul Kahf, the people of the cave. The second question they asked, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّحِ, was regarding the soul. And the third question they asked was, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ, or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they asked you about Dhulqarnayn. These are the three questions they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to test and to see whether he truly was the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What concerns us today is that who is the Dhulqarnayn referred to in the Quran? As by learning who the Dhulqarnayn is referred to in the Quran, we will be able to determine the time and period of the story of Dhulqarnayn and Ya'juj and Ma'juj. There have been many people in history with the name Dhulqarnayn, and surprisingly, each was given the laqab, the title Iskandar Alexander. The last famous person called Iskandar Alexander was Sikandar Yunani, or known to you and I as Alexander the Great, a king who lived around 300 years before Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, the one who built Alexandria. Now the Dhulqarnayn referred to in the Quran, the one whom, regarding the Jews, questioned Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, though there is a difference of opinion between the ulama in whether the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran was a prophet or not, one thing is for certain and is agreed upon, that the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran was a pious and just king. At the same time, the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran is not Alexander the Great, as is the opinion of many great masters like Ibn Hajr al-Asqalani rahmahullah and Ibn Kathir rahmahullah. The reason I have mentioned this is because some commentators of the Quran, some mufassireen like Abu Hayyan in Al-Bahr al-Muhit, Allama Alusi rahmahullah in Luh al-Ma'ani, have mentioned that the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran is Alexander the Great, Iskandar Maktuni. They base their opinion on a hadith which is narrated by Uqbah ibn Amir and can be found in Tabari. كَأَنَّهُ كَانَ شَابًا مِنَ الرُّومِ وَأَنَّهُ بَنَى الْإِسْكَنْدَرِيَّةِ وَأَنَّهُ عَلَى بِهِ مَلَكٌ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَذَهَبَ بِهِ إِلَى السَّدْ إِلَى آخِرِ الْحَدِيثِ. They base their opinion on this hadith. However, the masters of hadith say that this hadith is da'if. This hadith is weak. Thus, this hadith cannot be taken. And the reality of the matter is, like Ibn Hajr al-Asqalani and Ibn Kathir rahimahullah have said, that the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran is not Alexander the Great due to three reasons. Firstly, the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran was a believer, was a Muslim, and his wazir was Sayyidina Khadir, while Alexander the Great was not a believer, he was a kafir, and his wazir was Aristophanes. So firstly, Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran was a Muslim, while Alexander was a kafir. Secondly, Dhulqarnain was an Arab and he has been mentioned a lot in their poetry, while Alexander the Great was not an Arab, he was from Yunnan, a Greek. Thirdly, Alexander lived 300 years before Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, while Dhulqarnain lived at the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam also prayed for him. It is narrated, أَنَّ ذَا الْقَرْنَيْنِ حَجَّ مَاشِيًا فَسَمِيَ بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ فَتَلَقَّى. Now Dhulqarnain, when he went for Hajj, he went walking. When Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam heard that Dhulqarnain was coming for Hajj, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam went to greet Dhulqarnain. So we learn that the Dhulqarnain referred to in the Quran was not Alexander the Great, but a pious king that lived at the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. From this we can determine that the story that the Quran is relating of Dhulqarnain and Ya'juj and Ma'juj is a story of about the time of around Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Quran thereafter says, Inna makkanna lahu fil ardi wa ataynahu min kulli shay'in sababa. Dhulqarnain was a pious and just ruler. He traveled to many lands, establishing justice and the law of Allah therein. Inna makkanna lahu fil ard. Allah established him within the land and provided him with all forms of material strength through which he was able to carry out his conquests and missions. Imam Qurtubi rahimahullah has said, كَأَنَّ جَمِيعَ مُلُوكِ الدُّنْيَا كُلِّهَا أَرْبَعَ مُؤْمِنَانَ وَكَافِرَانَ. There are only four people have ever ruled the entire world. Two were believers and two were non-believers. The non-believers, Nimrod and Bukhtinassar, and the two believers, Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam and Dhulqarnain, Iskandar. ف فأتبع سببا حتى إذا بلغ مغرب الشمس وجدها تغرب في عين حمئة ووجد عندها قوما.
Once Dhulqarnain carried out a mission in three directions: the far west, the far east, and then in a northerly direction. He first traveled to the west, conquering the lands he passed through and establishing the law of Allah therein. He kept on traveling in the westly direction till he reached the setting of the sun. He found that it set in a muddy spring, and nearby it he found a people which were not believers, as the following verse of the Quran indicates.
قُلْنَا يَا ذَا الْقَرْنَيْنِ إِمَّا أَن تُعَذِّبَ وَإِمَّا أَن تَتَّخِذَ فِيهِمْ حُسْنًا.
He was given a choice by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He could either punish these people for their kufr, or either he could be lenient with them and give them da'wah and invite them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhulqarnain chose the latter, and he invited them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said to them, أَمَّا مَنْ ظَلَمْ فَسَوْفَ نُعَذِّبُهُ ثم يرد إلى ربه فيعذبه عذابا نكرا.
That whoever does injustice on his soul, on himself, by rejecting the da'wah, by not believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by denying the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فسوف نعذبه, then we will severely punish him in this world. We will punish him in this world by killing him. ثم يرد إلى ربه فيعذبه عذاب النكرة. Then he will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Creator will also severely punish him, and the sin and the fire of hell will be his abode.
وأما من آمن وعمل صالحا فله جزاء الحسنى وسنقول له من أمرنا يسرا.
As for him who accepts the da'wah and who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thereafter does good deeds, فَلَهُ جَزَاءً الْحُسْنَ, for him there is a good reward in the hereafter, the reward of Jannah, the reward of paradise. وَسَنَقُولَ لَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِنَا يُسْرًا, and we will also be lenient with him in this world.
After his journey towards the far west, he prepared for his journey towards the east.
ثُمَّ أَتْبَأَ سَبَبًا حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ مَطْلِعَ الشَّمْسِ وَجَدَهَا تَطْلُؤُ عَلَى قَوْمٍ لَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُمْ مِنْ دُونِهَا سِتْرًا كَذَلِكَ وَقَدْ أَحَطْنَا بِمَا لَدَيْهِ خُبْرًا.
His journey towards the far east was exactly like his journey towards the far west. He conquered the lands he passed through, establishing the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala therein. He traveled in the easterly direction, kept on traveling till he reached the rising of the sun. In this area of the east, he saw a nation receiving the sunshine without any obstruction. Perhaps these people were highly uncivilized and did not build houses or roofs just like some nomadic people do today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. What concerns us today is that he dealt with those in the east exactly like he dealt those with the west. And after completing his journey to the east, he made preparations for his third journey.
ثم أتبع سببا حتى إذا بلغ بين السدين وجد من دونهما قوما لا يكادون يفقهون قولا.
He made preparations for his third journey. This third journey was apart from the east and west in some third direction. Generally, the commentators of the Quran, the Mufassirin,
call it the northern journey. However, this is not clearly given in any verse of the Quran or any ahadith. There is an indication that this journey was in the north, in the northerly direction. He traveled and kept on traveling till he reached the midst of two mountains. It was here Dhulqarnain came across a tribe of people who complained to him about the two tribes, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Now these two mountains formed a barrier between the people and Ya'juj and Ma'juj. The Ya'juj and Ma'juj could not climb the two mountains. However, there was a gorge between the two mountains, and the Ya'juj and Ma'juj would come through this gorge, they would plunder the people, and then they would run away. Dhulqarnain was a stranger to these people. But when they saw his extraordinary ways and means, when they observed his great pomp and power, they thought, this is the person who can save them from the great disaster which they often bore at the hands of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Thus they said to him, Ya Dhulqarnain, إِنَّ يَعْجُوجَ وَمَعْجُوجَ مُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَهَلْ نَجْعَلُ لَكَ خَرْجًا عَلَىٰ أَنْ تَجْعَلَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُمْ سَدًّا. O Dhulqarnain, Ya'juj and Ma'juj have been creating great corruption in our land for a long time. They plunder us, they steal our food, they commit bloodshed, and then they run away. Please, will you erect a barrier for our protection, and we will pay you well in the form of tax. This is the verse of the Quran in which Ya'juj and Ma'juj have been mentioned. Many questions arise in regards to the Ya'juj and Ma'juj which need to be answered, as there are many myths surrounding the Ya'juj and Ma'juj, and many people seem to believe all sorts of extraordinary things regarding the Ya'juj and Ma'juj which are not proven from any verse of the Quran or any hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many questions arise. Are they the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yourselves and I, or are they some third being, as many people seem to believe? If they are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yourselves and I, is it true that they are only the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam and not the children of Hazrat Hawa alayhi salam, as some people seem to believe? What do they look like? When will they appear? What will they do when they appear? How powerful are they? Where are they now? What are they doing now? Do they exist now? Let us try to answer some of these questions very briefly in the light of the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many people seem to believe that the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are some third being. They are not the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yourselves and I. Many people seem to believe this. However, this belief is completely wrong and baseless, as the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam clearly indicate and clearly suggest that Ya'juj and Ma'juj are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yourselves and I, and from the progeny of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. Abdullah ibn Amr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu narrates, كَأَنَّ يَعْجُوجَ وَمَعْجُوجَ مِنْ وُلْدِ آدَمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ لَوْ أُرْسِلُوا إِلَى النَّاسِ لَأَفْسَدُوا عَلَيْهِمْ مَآيِشَهُمْ وَلَنْ يَمُوتَ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا تَرَكَ مِنْ ذُرِّيَتِهِ أَلْفًا فَسَاعِدًا. The Ya'juj and Ma'juj are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Not one will die from amongst them 3,000 are born to him. In the hadith, والذي يدل على أنه من ذرية آدم عليه السلام ما رواه البخاري عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه. It is narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari on the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله تعالى عنه that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, يقول الله تعالى يا آدم فيقول لبيك وسعديك والخير في يديك فيقول أخرج بعث النار. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, O Adam, take out the Jahannami from your progeny. Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam will ask, وَمَا بَعْثُ النَّارِ. O Allah, who are the Jahannami from my progeny? Who are the people that will have to go into the fire of hell? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reply, مِنْ كُلِّ أَلْفٍ تِسْءُمِئَةٍ وَتِسْءَةٍ وَتِسْءٍ. That from every 1,999 are Jahannami. فعنده يشيب الصغير وتضأ كل ذات حمل حملها وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. When the Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين heard what Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, overtaken by fear, they asked, يا رسول الله وأينا ذلك الواحد. O Messenger of Allah, who is that one lucky person from amongst us? Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, seeing that the Sahaba had become very worried and were overtaken by fear, when he saw them very frightened, he consoled them and said, أَبْشِرُوا فَإِنَّ مِنْكُمْ رَجُلًا وَمِنْ يَعْجُوجُ مَعْجُوجًا أَلْفٌ وَصَحَابَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ أَنْ مَجْمَعِينَ Do not worry, as the 999 will be from the Ya'juj and Ma'juj. In another hadith also narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr رضي الله تعالى عنه, he says, كَالْجِنُّ وَالْإِنْسُ عَشَرَةُ أَجْزَاءُ فَتِسْأَةُ أَجْزَاءُ يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ وجزء سائر الناس. He says that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divided mankind into 10 parts. فَتِسْأَةُ أَجْزَاءُ يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ. 9/10 of mankind constitute يَعْجُوجُ مَعْجُوجُ وجزء سائر الناس, while the rest of mankind, 1/10 constitutes the rest of mankind. From these ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the two ahadith of Abdullah ibn Amr radiallahu ta'ala an, and the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala an, and the verse of the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا ذُرِّيَّتَهُ هُمُ الْبَاقِينَ, it is clearly evident that the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yours and I, and from the progeny of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, and they constitute 9/10 of mankind, and they are not, and they are no third being, as many people seem to believe. And the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr, it is very clear, إِنَّ يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ مِنْ وَلْدِ آدَمْ, that يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. So those people that believe that they are some third being have based their opinion on something that is baseless, on something that cannot be justified. Now that we have learned that they are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yourselves and I, many people believe that yes, they are the children of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, like yourselves and I, but they are not the children of Hazrat Hawa alayhi salam. And they base their opinion on what has been narrated by Ka'ab, كَأَنَّهُمْ مِنْ وُلْدِ آدَمْ مِنْ غَيْرِ هَوَىٰ وَذَلِكَ أَنَّ آدَمْ نَامَ فَاحْتَلَمَ فامتزجت نطفته بالتراب فخلق منها يعجوج ومعجوج. كاب نريد كهم من ولد آدم من غير هوا, that they are the children of Sayyidina Adam عليه السلام, but not the children of Hazrat Hawa عليه السلام. That is because أن آدم نام فاحتلم, that when Sayyidina Adam عليه السلام was sleeping, and whilst he was sleeping he had احتلام, a wet dream, and the semen fell to the ground, it intermingled with the earth. فَخُلِكَ مِنْهَا يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ, the يَعْجُوجُ and مَعْجُوجُ were created from that particular semen. They base their opinion on what has been narrated by Ka'ab. However, this opinion on what has been narrated by Ka'ab is objectionable and questionable, because the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, as many hadith clearly indicate, do not have ihtilam, do not have a wet dream, and the wet dream, ihtilam, is from the shaitan. And the shayateen have no effect on the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. Secondly, in a marfu hadith, it is clearly stated, أَنَّهُمْ مِنْ ذُرِيَةِ نُوْءٍ وَنُوءٍ مِنْ ذُرِيَةِ آدَمُ وَحَوَاءَ قَطْءًا. In a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is clearly stated that they are from the children and the progeny of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. And Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, without a doubt, was a child and a descendant from Hazrat Adam alayhi salam and also Hazrat Hawa alayhi salam. So from this we can conclude how baseless their opinion is that the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are only the children of Hazrat Adam alayhi salam and not the children of Hazrat Hawa alayhi salam. The correct belief is of the Ahl Sunnah that they are the children of Hazrat Adam alayhi salam and also the children of Hazrat Hawa alayhi salam, like yourselves and I. Another question which arises is, what do they look like? As there are many, many myths surrounding their appearance. There have been many, many asar and many, many narrations mentioned in regards to their appearance. A brief summary of what these narrations suggest is that the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are of three types. Some sinful ajdaduhum kal ard wa huwa shajarun kibarun jidda. Some are as tall as the tree abus, which is around 120 feet. Sinful arba'atu azru'in fi arba'ati azru'in. Some are 4 spans tall and 4 spans wide. وَصِنْفٌ يَفْتَرِشُونَ آذَانَهُمْ وَيَلْتَحِفُونَ بِالْأُخْرَى. Some spread one ear to sleep on and they use the other ear to cover their bodies. In some narration it is stated أَنَّ طُولَهُمْ شِبْرٌ وَشِبْرَيْنَ وَأَطْوَلَهُمْ ثَلَاثَةُ أَشْبَارٍ, that they are only 1 or 2 spans tall and the tallest amongst them is 3 spans. However, I would like to mention and make it very clear that all these asar, all the narrations that suggest what I have just mentioned, are all weak and cannot be taken. وَالَّذِي تَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ الرِّوَايَاتُ صَحِيحًا أَنَّهُمْ رِجَالٌ أَقْوِيَاءُ لَا طَاقَةَ لِأَحَدِهِمْ بِقِتَالِهِمْ وَيُبْعِدْ أَنْ يَكُونَ طُولُ أَحَدِهِمْ شِبْرٌ وَشِبْرَيْنَ. The authentic ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like the hadith of Nawas bin Sam'an, which can be found in Sahih Muslim, which we will soon deal with. These ahadithes, the authentic ahadithes, clearly suggest أَنَّهُمْ رِجَالٌ أَقْوِيَاءُ لَا طَاقَةَ لِأَحَدٍ بِقِتَالِهِمْ. The Ya'juj and Ma'juj are very, very powerful people and nobody has the power to fight with them. In the hadith which can be found in Musnad Ahmad, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said كَأَنَّهُمْ أَنَّكُمْ تَقُولُونَ لَا عَدُوٌ أَنَّكُمْ تُقَاتِلُونَ عَدُوًا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ إِرَادُ الْوُجُوهِ صِغَارُ الْعُيُونِ شهب الشعاف من كل حدب ينسلون كأن وجوههم المجان المطرقة. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said that you say there is no enemy. إنكم تقاتلون عدوا حتى يأتي يأجوج ومأجوج. لا تزالون تقاتلون عدوا, that you will keep on fighting the enemy till يأجوج and مأجوج come. إراب الوجوه, their faces will be wide. صغار العيون, their eyes small. شهب الشعاف, their hair grey. من كل حدب ينسلون, they will come forth from every lofty place. كأن وجوههم المجان المطرقة, their faces will look like shields covered with skin. So my brothers and sisters, from the authentic ahadithes we learn that the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are a people which are so powerful that nobody will be able to fight them. Their faces will be broad, their eyes will be small, greyish of hair, and their faces will look like skin, shields covered with skin. This is the description of the Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Going back to the verse of the Quran, إن يعجوج ومعجوج مفسدون في الأرض فهل نجعل لك خرجا على أن تجعل بيننا وبينهم سدا. When these people saw the extraordinary ways and means of Dhulqarnain, and when they observed his great pomp and power, they thought that this is the person that can save them from the great disaster which they often bore at the hands of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. So they asked him, O Dhulqarnain, Ya'juj and Ma'juj have been creating great corruption in our land for a long time. They commit, they plunder us, steal our food, commit bloodshed, and then run away. They asked him if he was prepared to set a barrier for them, and in return they were ready to pay for its expenses in the form of tax. Dhulqarnain replied, قَالَ مَا مَكَّنِّي فِيهِ رَبِّي خَيْرٌ فَأَعِيُونِي بِقُوَّةٍ أَجْعَلْ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ رَدْمًا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me sufficient wealth. Aid me with labor. Help me, and I will erect this barrier for you. آتوني زبر الحديد حتى إذا ساوى بين الصدفين قال انفخوا حتى إذا جعله نارا قال آتوني أفرغ عليه قطرا فما استطاعوا أن يظهروه وما استطاعوا له نقبا. First big ignits of iron was set one upon the other, and when they rose high up to the peaks of the two mountains, he ordered the people, unfukhu, blow them. When the iron became hot like fire, he ordered them to pour molten copper upon the ignis, which entered into the crevices of the ignis, making it very hard like a mountain. When the gate was ready, the Quran says, فَمَا اسْطَاعُوا أَنْ يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَا اسْطَاعُوا لَهُ نَقْبَةً. That they were not given power to cross it or pierce the gate. Now the question that needs to be answered here is, where is this iron gate of Dhulqarnain? My brothers and sisters, many, many opinions and many, many different opinions have been expressed as to the location and situation of this iron gate of Dhulqarnain. Many, many books have also been written on the subject. The best piece I came across was the work of Shaykh Hizr Rahman Rahmahullah, Shaykh Hizr Rahman's work, Qasasul Quran. Shaykh Hizr Rahman thoroughly research the subject. Let me very briefly share a summary of what Shaykh Hizr Rahman has written in Qasasul Quran. Shaykh Hizr Rahman rahimahullah has written that the Ya'juj and Ma'juj caused destruction in such a vast area that from one side all those who live near Caucasia were their target and prey, and from the other side those that lived in Tibet and China were their target and prey. And because of this oppression and destruction, many, many barriers and walls were erected in different times, different places, by different kings, four being the most famous. Firstly, the Great Wall of China, which was built by the Chinese king Fa Fo around 3,460 years after the coming of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam to earth. Secondly, the wall in Central Asia near Bukhara and Tirmiz in a place called Durbain, which was already present at the time of the king Timur Ling. Thirdly, the war in Dagestan, Russia, also in a place called Derbent, a town near the Caspian Sea. And the fourth wall is in the westerly direction of the third one, in the region of the Caucasus. These are the four most famous walls. Shaykh Ibn Rahman further writes, because these walls were all built for one purpose and are all situated in the north, it has always been very difficult to determine which is the wall of Dzulqarnayn. He further writes, the biggest wall out of the four walls is the Great Wall of China. And nobody is of the opinion that this is the wall Dzulqarnayn built, as this wall is in the far east. And the Quran indicates that the wall Dzulqarnayn built is in the northerly direction. This leaves three walls. The wall in Central Asia near Bukhara and Tirmiz, in a place called Derbent. The wall in Dagestan, Russia, also in a place called Derbent, near the a town near the Caspian Sea. And thirdly, the wall in the region of the Caucasus. Generally, the historians like Mas'udi, Istakhri and Hamawi are of the opinion that the wall of Dzulqarnayn is either the one in Dagestan, Russia, in a place called Derbent, or either the one in the region of the Caucasus. He writes, those that have said that the wall of Dzulqarnayn is the one near Bukhara and Tirmiz in a place called Derbent have become confused because of the place Derbent, which is near Bukhara and Tirmiz, and also in Dagestan, Russia, near the Caspian Sea. This leaves two walls, the one in Dagestan, Russia, in a place called Derbent, a town near the Caspian Sea, and secondly, the wall in the region of the Caucasus. Allama Anwar Shah Kashmiri, a master of a hadith of his time, is of the opinion and is written in his book Aqidatul Islam that the wall of Dzulqarnayn is the one in the region of the Caucasus. This is a very brief summary of what Shaykh Hifz al-Rahman has written in his book Qasas al-Quran. After mentioning this summary, I would like to conclude with the words of Allama Alusi rahmahullah, as I find myself inclined towards Allama Alusi rahmahullah's opinion. Allama Alusi rahmahullah has written that we do not know the location of the wall of Dzulqarnayn. We do not know where this wall is situated. It is very, very probable that there are great seas and mountains which lie between us and the wall of Dzulqarnayn, or Ya'juj and Ma'juj and the rest of the wall, of the world. This is Allama Alusi rahmahullah's opinion, and I find myself inclined towards Allama Alusi rahmahullah's opinion. The second question that needs to be answered regarding the wall is, has anybody ever seen the wall of Dzulqarnayn after, from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam onward? It is narrated by Qatada that he says, ذُكِرَ لَنَا كَأَنَّ رَجْلٌ قَالْ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ قَدْ رَأَيْتُ سَدَّ يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ. Qatada narrates that it has been related to us that a man said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, قَدْ رَأَيْتُ سَدَّ يَعْجُوجُ وَمَعْجُوجُ, that I have seen the wall of Dzulqarnayn. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him to describe it. In ajhuli, he replied, كَأَنَّهُ الْبُرْضُ الْمُحَبَّرُ طَرِيقَةٌ سَوْدَاءُ وَطَرِيقَةٌ حَمْرَاءُ قَالَ قَدْ رَأَيْتَهُ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him to describe the wall. He described the wall for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After describing the wall, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied in the affirmative, قَدْ رَأَيْتَهُ, that you definitely have seen the wall of Dzulqarnayn. So from this tradition, it is clearly evident that yes, somebody has definitely seen the wall from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam onwards. Many kings in different times sent their troops and armies to look for this wall. In Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya of Ibn Kathir, Ibn Kathir has mentioned that the Khalif Wasiq Billah sent his army to look for the wall of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. He writes that they were absent for 2 years, traveling from one city to another, one town to another, looking for the wall of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. They finally found this wall, and they saw that it had a big door, وَعَلَيْهِ أَقْفَالٌ عَظِيمَةٌ, and big padlocks on the doors, وَشَاهَدُوا أَهْوَالٌ وَعَجَائِبٌ, and they saw extraordinary things. However, Ibn Kathir rahimahullah has mentioned this story in his tafsir and also in his tarikh, history al-bidayah wal-nihayah, وَلَمْ يَذْكُرْ لَهَا سَنَدًا وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِصِحَّةِ ذَلِكَ. He has not mentioned a chain for this story, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how authentic this narration is, how authentic this story is. At this moment in time, the Ya'juj and Ma'juj are trying to dig and break through the wall of Dhulqarnayn. Narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ يَعْجُوجَ وَمَعْجُوجَ يَحْفُرُونَ السَّدَّ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ حَتَّى إِذَا كَادُوا يَرَوْنَ شُوَاعَ الشَّمْسِ قَالَ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِمْ اِرْجِعُوا فَتَحْفُرُونَهُ غَدًا. That the Ya'juj and Ma'juj break and dig through the wall erected by Dhulqarnayn, and they keep on digging to the till they reach the end, to the extent that they can actually see the light coming from the other side. قَالَ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِمْ, the Amir says to them, إِرْجِعُوا, return, فَتَحْفَرُونَهُ غَدًا, we will finish the work tomorrow. They return, فَيُعِيدَهُ اللَّهُ وَهُوَ كَهِيهَتِهِ يَوْمَ تَرَكُوهُ. They return, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the wall to revert to its original thickness. Next day they come, they dig and they keep on digging and breaking the wall of Dhulqarnayn till they get to the end, to the extent that they are able to see the rays of light on the other side. Yet again the Amir says to them, return, we will finish the work tomorrow. They return, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the wall to revert to its original thickness. And this will keep on happening, حتى إذا جاء الوقت قال إن شاء الله فيحفرونه ويخرجون على الناس. This will keep on happening till the time comes for them to be released. On that night, they will say, Insha'Allah, let us return and we will finish the work tomorrow, Insha'Allah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. They will return home. Next day when they come, they will find that the wall is exactly as they left it. They will break the remaining wall and they will emerge. This is what the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu states. However, I would like to mention here that some ulama have written that this narration or story was taken from the Bani Israel, was taken from the Jews, and thus it cannot be taken because it contradicts the verse of the Quran, فَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ أَنْ يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ لَوْ نَقْبَى, that they will not be able to cross it or pierce it. However, I would like to mention that the great master of hadith, Ibn Hajr al-Asqalani, who has written the best commentary on Sahih al-Bukhari to date, he has narrated this hadith in Fath al-Bari on the authority of Abd ibn Humayd and Sahih ibn Hibban, on the authority of Abd ibn Humayd and Ibn Hibban. And he writes that the narrations go back to Qatada. He writes that in some of the narrations, in the chains, some of the narrators, the Rijal, are of Sahih al-Bukhari. And at the same time, he has not raised any doubt in this being a marfu' hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Instead, after narrating this hadith, he writes that Ibn al-Arabi has said that there are three miracles evident in this hadith. First, الأولى أن الله منعهم أن يوالوا الحفر ليلا ونهارا. That it never occurs to these people that they must continue work during the night, because they are in such large numbers that they can easily delegate the work amongst themselves and work in shift. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow this thought to occur to them. Secondly, منعهم أن يحاولوا الرقي على سد بسلم أو آلة فلم يلحمهم ذلك. It never occurs to these people that they can merrily cross the mountain or scale the wall which they can do through the aid of equipment which they possess in large numbers. This never occurs to them. And thirdly, أنه صدهم أن يقولوا إن شاء الله حتى يجيء الوقت المحدود. It never occurs to these people to say إن شاء الله if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will. And it will never occur to them to say إن شاء الله till the time comes for them to be released. So Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, after narrating this hadith, has mentioned these three miracles which Ibn al-Arabi rahmahullahu has related and written. If the opinion of Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is taken and it is proven that this hadith was not taken from the Bani Israel, was not taken from the Jews, and I find myself inclined towards Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani's opinion, even then this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not contradict the verse of the Quran, فَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ أَنْ يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ لَهُ نَقْبًا, as the verse of the Quran that they were not given power by God to pierce it and cross it is referring to the time of Dhulqarnain, that after when Dhulqarnain built the wall they were not given power at that time by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cross the wall or pierce the wall. Thus there is no contradiction. Secondly, فَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ أَنْ يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ لَهُ نَقْبًا, the word naqb means a complete hole, that they will not be able to make a complete hole. And the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an clearly suggests that they are not able to make a complete hole. They get to the extent that they are able just to see light, rays of light coming in through the wall, but they are not able to make a complete hole. So there is no contradiction if the opinion of Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah was taken between this hadith and the words of the Quran, فَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ أَنْ يَظْهَرُوا وَمَا اسْتَطَاءُ لَهُ نَكْبًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam. Now let us move on to the hadith of Nawas bin Sam'an radiallahu ta'ala an. As the hadith of Nawas bin Sam'an radiallahu ta'ala an clearly describes what the Ya'juj and Ma'juj will do when they appear. After a short period after Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam has killed the Dajjal, a short period after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reveal to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, كَأَنِّي قَدْ أَخْرَجْتُ عِبَادَنِّي لَا يُدَانُ لِأَحْدٍ بِقِتَالِهِمْ فَحَرِّزْ عِبَادِي إِلَى التُّورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reveal to him that I am taking out servants of mine which nobody has the power to fight with. فَحَرِّزْ عِبَادِي إِلَى التُّورِ. Just take the believers for their protection to Mount Tur. وَيَبْعَثُ اللَّهُ يَعْجُوجَ وَمَأْجُوجَ وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ حَدْبٍ يَنْسِلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the Ya'juj and Ma'juj, and they will come forth from every lofty place causing fitna and devastation and bloodshed and destruction wherever they go. فَيَمُرُّ أَوَائِلَهُمْ عَلَى بُحَيْرَةَ بَرِيَّةَ فَيَشْرَبُونَ مَا فِيهَا وَيَمُرُّ آخِرَهُمْ فَيَقُولَ لَقَدْ كَانَ بِهَذِهِ مَرَّةً مَاءٌ. Their first batch will reach the lake of Tiberias, and their first batch will drink all the water of Lake Tiberias. There will not be a single drop of water left inside this lake. When the last batch passes by the same lake, they will say, لَقَدْ كَانَ بِهَذِهِ مَرَّةً مَاءٌ. We're sure that at one time there was water inside this lake. They will cause fitna and devastation and destruction wherever they go. They will proceed, ثم يسيرون حتى ينتهوا إلى جبل الخمر وهو جبل ببيت المقدس. They will proceed and move on till they reach جبل الخمر, Mount Khamar, and mountain in بيت المقدس. They will say, لقد قتلنا من في الأرض هلما فلنقتل من في السماء, that we have killed those within the earth, let us now kill those within the heavens. فيرمون بنشابهم إلى السماء فيرد الله عليهم نشابهم مخضوبة دما. They will shoot the arrows towards the heavens, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will return the arrows covered with blood, and these fools will think that they have killed those within the heavens. Meanwhile, ويحصر نبي الله وأصحابه حتى تكون رأس الثور لأحدهم خيرا من مئة دينار لأحدكم اليوم. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and the believers will remain confined to the mountain. They will have nothing much to eat till the head of an ox will be more valuable to one of them than 100 gold coins are to one of you today. فَيَرْغَبُ نَبِيُّ اللَّهِ إِيسَى وَأَصْحَابُهُ Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and the believers will sincerely turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they will sincerely pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their destruction. فَيُرْسِلُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمُ النَّغَفْ فِي رِقَابِهِمْ فَيُصْبِحُونَ فَرْتَ كَمَوْتِ نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer the prayer of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and the prayer of the believers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send insects upon their necks, and next morning they will be all found dead like the death of one man. In the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, it is narrated that morning the believers will not be able to hear their noise. They will say, هَلْ مِنْ رَجُلٍ يَسْتَرِي نَفْسَهُ فَيَنْظُرْ مَا فَعَلُوا Is there anybody who will volunteer and sacrifice his life and go see what the situation is? One of the believers will volunteer. He will come down the mountain. He will think that he will never return and the Ya'juj and Ma'juj will kill him. He will come down the mountain. He will see that they are all dead. He will say, أَبْشِرُوا Good tidings, good news, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken care of your enemy. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and the believers will descend, but they will find فَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَوْضِعَ شِبْرٍ إِلَّا مَلَأُوا زَهْمًا وَنَسْرَهُمْ They will find that the ground is covered with their stinky corpses and their fat, and their stinking fat. Yet again, for the second time, they will pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَيُرْسِلُ اللَّهُ طَيْرًا كَأَنَاكِ الْبُخْتِ فَتَحْمِلُهُمْ فَتَطْرُهُمْ حَيْثُ شَاءَ اللَّهُ For the second time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept the prayers of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam and will answer the prayer of the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send birds like the necks of bacterian camels. These birds will come and they will take their rotten corpses and their stinky fat to where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care and get rid of the fitna of the Ya'juj and Ma'juj from the surface of the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me the tawfiq to ask from Allah, said, وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ